Good morning, and welcome to worship at St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church. Here are the announcements for this week. Our student ministry has developed a walking tour through downtown Wilmington to help us learn about what life is like in our city for those who are experiencing poverty. The walk is 1.3 miles long and takes about 90 minutes to complete. For more details or to schedule a time for your group to do this tour, contact Jen Phelps, Director of Youth Ministry. Both the adult choir and the adult handbells welcome new participants. For the choir, contact Angela Burns. For the handbells, contact Cindy Lissinger. Throughout September, we've been collecting items for our mercy pouches. We currently need individual packs of tuna, fruit cups, and servings of pudding cups. Donations can be dropped off at the church office this week, Monday through Thursday, from 9 to 5. Volunteers are needed to teach Sunday school classes for preschool through grade 12. If you're interested in helping with preschool through grade 5, contact Lynn Warner. If you want to help with grades 6 through 12, contact Jen Phelps. The Disciples 3 Bible study began Thursday via Zoom and will continue throughout the fall. It's a study of Old Testament prophets and the letters of Paul led by Sue McCaffrey and David Hoff. All are encouraged to participate. Now please join me in our call to worship from Psalm 63. O God, you are my God, and I long for you. My whole being desires you. Like a dry, worn out, and waterless land, my soul is thirsty for you. Let me see you in the sanctuary. Let me see how mighty and glorious you are. Your constant love is better than life itself, and so I will praise you. I will give you thanks as long as I live. I will raise my hands to you in prayer. Very crucial to maintaining a close and intimate walk with the Lord is regularly confessing our sins. To that end, I invite you to join with me in the prayer of confession. Let us pray. Holy and forgiving God, we confess that we have sinned against you. We have not kept our end of the covenant. We have broken your law and your heart. Some of the sins we know, the thoughts and words and deeds of which we are ashamed, but some are known only to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask for forgiveness. Deliver us and restore us that we may live in peace. Amen. Please take a moment now for silent confession of sin. The same God who commands us to regularly confess our sins has provided, through Jesus Christ, an advocate, a mediator, one who died on the cross so that our sins would be forgiven. And when we confess those sins before God, when we do it humbly and with contrition, he forgives our sins and cleanses us from our unrighteousness. As we have done that, I declare that in Jesus Christ's name, we are forgiven. Amen.
Hey, everyone. So today, I brought some fruit. I thought I'd make a fruit salad. Don't you love a fruit salad? You know, I love bananas by themselves. They taste really good. And I love grapes. I love to eat grapes by themselves. Or a pear. Or an apple. They all have their own flavors, their own textures, and that's really cool. Sometimes you're in the mood for one or another. But what about when you mix them together? Then all their flavors mix together, and it's really good. You know, you're saying, what does this have to do with God, Miss Lynn? It has everything to do with God. Just like all these fruits are awesome on their own, they're better together. And that's the way it is with us. God's given each one of these fruits their certain flavor, the gift that they have. And he's given each of us gifts as well. And we can do things great on our own, but we do them better with others. If we work together, it's something completely different. So, let's make some fruit salad together as children of God and work together to share God's love and to spread it all over the place so that we have some awesome fruit salad and show God's love and all the wonderful gifts he's given us. So, what are your gifts? What do you think the gifts are of the people around you? How could you work together? Things to think about. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for all the many gifts you give us. Gifts of our personality, of the talents we might have, of the caring we can offer, and the foods you give us. Fruits and vegetables and all kinds of foods. They're great on their own, but they're often better together, just as you intended us to be. So help us, oh God, to share your love and to be better together. And all God's people said, Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning consists of one single verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. God loves a cheerful giver. End of verse. Two things as we begin our time together this morning, or whenever you're watching this, that I want you to be aware of. First of all, while it's going to come across this way, because that's how I'm wired, this is not a sermon. And secondly, leading from that, this is rather from Robert Bailey, the man who attends St. Andrew's Covenant. This is my home church. This is where I worship. This is where I give my tithes. This is my church family. So what I'm sharing with you today comes from that perspective, not as your pastor during interim time. This is a story of a journey in the land of giving. You notice that our title this morning of our reflections is Your Giving Journey. So I want us to look at this as a journey, because by now most of you have heard the annual stewardship sermons that all of us pastors preach, and you can probably recite from memory some of the scriptures, because we tell you the same thing once a year, every year. So I'm not going to do that. While I will weave some of those scriptures into what I'm sharing, this is not a stewardship sermon. This is a story. It's my own story about my journey in the land of giving. That's what I'm calling it. I've never thought of that before, but I'm calling it the land of giving. I began this land of giving and my journey in it when I encountered the Lord of that land the evening that Christ came into my life. It was a land of giving because at that moment I gave my life to Jesus Christ. It was the most singular, most important act of giving I have ever engaged in or will ever engage in because it began that night and it continues to this day and will continue until I go to be with Him, that ongoing giving of my life to Jesus Christ. When Paul was interacting with early Christians in the Corinthian church, he had to deal particularly not so much with the Jews who understood the concept of giving and tithing in particular, but with Gentiles who had no concept of giving to anybody. Giving wasn't a part of their economy and their mindset. They were very selfish. They were very materialistic. And so Paul talked to them about their giving, and he was impressed by the fact that when he asked them to give money to help others, a new concept, give money to help others, he records in that section of 2 Corinthians that first they gave themselves to the Lord. Well, that's what I'm starting with in this time together, that singular most important act of giving is giving ourselves to the Lord. And Paul says that's what they did. So when we talk about your giving journey, that's where your giving journey needs to begin as well. Somewhere in your life where you know that you have given your life to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, because that establishes a relationship. And listen to what I want to say here, because this is where it's so important for me. That establishes the relationship within which all other kinds of giving occur, including our monetary giving, but not limited to that, although that's our primary focus this morning. It's the beginning of a journey that's always in the context of a relationship with Jesus Christ. Soon after that experience, I graduated from high school and I began to learn about tithing in the Bible. A new understanding of a relationship between my money, as limited as it was for me as a teenager, and God. So I want to share with you this morning three kinds of monetary giving that are a part of my life, a part of our lives as my wife and I give together. Again, this is my story as a man who is a Christian who worships at his home church, St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church, and my relationship with my money in my relationship with my home church. Three kinds of monetary giving. First is tithes. I've already alluded to that. Malachi 3:10, and here's that verse you've heard every stewardship Sunday, but it's a part of my story, my journey. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse of the temple, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. That's from Malachi 3:10. So even before I graduated from high school, because I became a Christian in the summer before my last year of high school, I was earning money. I was doing a little bit of babysitting. Basically, I was mowing lawns and delivering newspapers early in the morning on weekdays and weekends. And so I took that money and I gave 10% of it to the church that I was attending at the time. When I went away to college and had college jobs, I tithed on all that I earned to whatever church I was attending at that time. And here's a sidebar observation. Over the years, I've heard people talk about tithing their gross versus their net. Ruth and I have always tithed on our gross. For one thing, it's a lot easier to figure out because we also feel that our taxes are our money being used to purchase things for us, such as safe streets and fire and police protection and things. That's not money that's being thrown away. It's our money. It's buying something for us in our larger community where we live. See, the one thing we felt was that it was easier, again, to just tithe on the gross because we know that figure rather than trying to deduct taxes first. So whether you tithe, if you are tithing now or are willing to move up to that in your giving, whether you tithe on your gross or your net, that's between you and the Lord. It really is. There's no explicit rule that talks about that in Scripture. I think God left that out for a good reason. But the one thing I would ask of you is that whatever you decide as you consider it, that you not put yourself in a position where you find yourself trying to figure out how to give God less. Let me say that again. Whatever you decide and wherever you arrive in your decision, if you are tithing or are willing to move up to that, just don't put yourself in a position where you're trying to figure out how to give God less. God said in that verse that there would be enough in his storehouse, which was a storehouse literally in the temple in Jerusalem where people gave their tithes. In other words, there's going to be enough for everything that we need to do as a church, for everything we want to do as a church. The money is already here. It really is. I say that cautiously and maybe carefully but and respectfully, but the money that we need to do everything we need to do and everything we want to do, everything we'd love to do in ministry and outreach, if we had the money, it's already in St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church. It's a matter of people making the decision prayerfully to contribute in a way that meets those needs and beyond, you see. Well, as I said, Ruth and I have always pledged on that in terms of our growth. And I'm not asking you to do something that I'm not willing to do. It's awkward to talk about our giving because it's a private thing. But I can't ask you to do something I'm not willing to do. So I have a written contract in this church. Yeah, there's a line item for business meals and that kind of a stuff. That's not income. But everything that this church gives me in my contract, regardless of how it's divided up, whether it covers Social Security offset or whether it covers Medicare insurance premiums for Medicare supplement medical, that's all money they're giving to me to pay for things that I am able to pay for. All of that gets tithed on, and I'm asking you to join me in a similar commitment. I'm asking you, will you join me in a commitment in 2022 to tithing to this home church, that there might be enough, as God's word promises, and he says, I'll pour out blessings on you won't imagine. That's not primarily financial blessings. It's incredible blessings of being used by God in this place that we have yet to see that he wants to do. That following year after I graduated from high school, I know I'm bouncing back and forth between Ruth and me and college, but I want to go to the second encounter of a monetary giving model. I referenced at the beginning that there were three kinds of monetary giving. The first is tithing, and the second is not tithing, but offerings, tithes and offerings. I'd never thought of these as two separate things until I began to experience this in a Christian college. In Luke, Jesus tells the story of the widow who puts everything she had in the offering. So this wasn't a tithe. This was above the tithe. This was beyond the tithe. This was everything she had, actually. Christian college I went to was a whole new culture for me as a Presbyterian growing up in a Presbyterian church. And every fall, they would have a missions conference. And for a week, we had chapel every day anyway, but for a week, every day in chapel, and then every evening in chapel, we had missionary speakers, and they would tell us stories of how the Holy Spirit was bringing people into the kingdom of God. People were finding Christ. Churches were being established and built. Clinics were being established to help people. All kinds of things that God was doing through these missionaries. And we would then make pledges as students. We were all poor college students. We were all working. I was working 30 hours a week throughout all my college years to put myself through college. I had no other resources. And my father wouldn't help me because he said I'd be giving to that church, and he was very opposed to any church, didn't matter what it was. And so we would make offering commitments to this missionary endeavor, and we students would raise thousands and thousands of dollars for missions, above our tithes, still giving a tithe to the local church. One Sunday, as I was working my way through college, I worked in drive-in dairies, and I had to go to work sometimes on Sunday mornings. I found a church that had services at like 8 o'clock. So I could go to that service and then still go to work on that Sunday morning. And I still will never forget sitting. I could show you where I was sitting. This is how these things happen in our lives. And the offering started in the back for some reason. And they brought it to the front. And then they just brought it forward there that way. And I was sitting towards the front. And I knew they were getting closer with the plate, and I took out some change from my pocket. No, I took out some a dollar or a couple of dollars. I had like maybe $8 in my wallet. I mean, I was making only a dollar an hour or so. I had maybe $8 in my wallet. I took out a dollar, and I just had this sense of, no, I can't. I'm trying to save money on God here. And it was so powerful. And I kept, you know where this is going. I kept taking out bills until there were no bills left in my wallet. And then I reached into my pocket and I took out the loose change in my pocket. And when I did that, I sat there with that money in my hands and I was overwhelmed. I was overwhelmed with an awareness that God was going to bless me because of that. Not financially, but in here, in my inner being. I was being obedient. And when that plate came and I dropped every cent that I had on me in that plate, and I walked out of that church with no money on me, but with a gift that God gave me, the gift of learning about giving offerings above my tithe. So from the beginning of our marriage, back to marriage now, Ruth and I have not only tithed on our gross income as we do to this day, but we've given above that consistently without a break for 55 years. We give to the church where we are attending, but most of the time that's been the church where I was a pastor. We've pledged to missionaries. Our heart is for missions. We've pledged to missionaries. We've pledged to missionary projects. We've given one-time lump sum gifts to those kinds of things, mostly overseas, but also local Christian ministries where we have pastored and where we've lived. We've established a scholarship at that Christian college, and we give to that monthly automatically, but it's above our tithe. We've never dipped into our tithes to give to missions or to other works in God's kingdom. That's always been what I'm saying is the second kind of monetary giving I want to share with you, and that's the category of offerings, you see. Offerings. So tithes, local church. Offerings, outside of local church. Missions, ministries, things that God puts on our heart to give to. So here's the third category. Tithes, offerings. And I've never heard anyone talk about this, but I'm going to talk about it because I've experienced it. I call this my encounter in this land of giving with what I call give it forward giving. Give it forward giving. Pay it forward. Paul wrote to these same Corinthians in this section about giving. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. What's he saying to them? He's saying, hey, you guys need to be willing to give because at some point, you're going to have a need and they're going to be able to reciprocate. They're going to be able to meet a need in your life because you're willing to give to the needs that are in their lives right now. How did I learn about this particular concept and dynamic and category of giving in this land of giving? I finished my first undergraduate degree in religion. And within a week or two of graduating, a retired pastor gentleman in the community who knew me through that school called the school because there were no cell phones or emails or anything. And he said, would you ask Robert Bailey to come over to my house sometime? And I just want to chat with him for a minute. So I went over there and I sat in his living room and I'll never forget what he said. He said, I was praying and he said, God put it in my heart to do something for you. He said, you've got a degree in religion, but he said, it's not practical. You really can't make a living with that undergraduate degree in religion. So he said, I want to encourage you to go back to school, same college, and get a teaching degree. And he handed me a check and he said, and here's the tuition for the first semester. I've never forgotten that. Years later, sitting in a worship service in Honduras, sitting in the back and just kind of drinking in that worship service in that Honduran gathering, I looked up and I happened to notice a young man sitting at a keyboard leading worship with a passionate heart for Jesus. And it just came to me so clearly. You know, when we say what God told me or the Holy Spirit told me, it's not like we hear voices. I know you've experienced the same thing. It's like you all of a sudden you're aware of something. You, quote, hear it, but it's not words that you're hearing. It's just something comes inside of us that's clear, and it has words attached to it. And all of a sudden, I looked at this young man, and I knew that the organization we were down there with had a scholarship program for putting people through university because they couldn't afford it on their own. And it just came so clear to me. You need to sponsor him and put him through university. So I spoke to the man who was in charge, and we met with the young man, and he He, tears came down his cheeks. He was overwhelmed that we wanted to do that for him. And so for $100 a month, that's all, $100 a month, that young man was able to go to university. He has since graduated, and we're now working with a second young man who's in university and doing the same thing. Why do I mention the amount? For one thing, it's incredible how little it takes to put somebody through school in these third world countries, but it's, you have to put that alongside of what they don't have. That's, they could never have paid that. But the other is that $100 is exactly the same amount that Pastor gave me so many decades ago. 50 decades ago. No, 50, 55, not decades, 55 years ago that he gave me that amount of money. And now I'm paying it forward, and we're still doing that right now. You see, I can't explain to you, but when I looked at that young man, what I felt in that pastor's living room was inside here. That man did something prompted by the Holy Spirit that lodged inside of me long after that money was spent on tuition. And at that moment, the Holy Spirit called on that giving experience I had had with that pastor, and I paid it forward, played it forward, gave it forward into that young man's life who's now graduated from university. I want to challenge you to be open to the Holy Spirit wanting to use you in someone's life the way that retired pastor was used in my life so many years ago, because that seed that was sown through his obedience to the Holy Spirit was planted in me and began to be bringing forth results and fruit in that encounter in Honduras, and right now is still being used by the Holy Spirit because I'm sharing that story with you. Be open to the Holy Spirit using you to give into someone else's life, trusting that if you are obedient, he will do in their life what he did in my life, and years later, they'll be giving it forward as well. We are Presbyterians who order ourselves according to Scripture, Book of Confessions, the Book of Order. And our Book of Order says this. This is taking the pulse of your giving journey. The disciplines of stewardship and self-offering are a grateful response to God's love for the world and self-giving in Jesus Christ. As Christians, we are called to live lives of simplicity, generosity, hospitality, compassion, and care for creation. Tithing is a primary practice of Christian stewardship and self-giving. And listen to what the Book of Order says. This is in the Directory of Worship in our Book of Order. We are accountable to God for how we use our material goods, spiritual gifts, and time in God's service. So that concludes my story of my journey in the land of giving, not as your pastor during interim time, but as someone for whom this is his home church, this is where I worship, this is where I give, so as there might be enough as the rest of us give as well in God's house for everything God is calling us to do. Here's my Monday morning assignment for you. There are more pieces to this assignment than usual. First of all, the questions. These are 4-5 questions. Have you given yourself to the Lord? That's the first giving we want to make sure we've engaged in. If you have, refresh that gift of your life to him. If you haven't, and you're aware that you haven't, that's because the Holy Spirit is giving you that awareness, and it's time for you to make that gift of yourself to him. Second question is, what is your household income? Third question is, what will be your total 2021 giving to God's work in and through St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church? And now there's going to be a giving grid, I hope, associated with this, where you can see, here's your annual income, here's percentages across the top, and here's the amount of dollars that that represents. But in any way you want to do it, figure out what your total giving for 2021 is and what percentage of your household income that represents. Find a percentage. The average giving for mainline Protestants and Presbyterians for decades has remained the same. And in the last two churches where I was an interim, in every church where I've been an interim, we've done mission studies, but in the last two in particular, people were asked anonymously to report their income, and they were right there with everybody else, 2%. That's the average amount that the average Presbyterian gives to their local church, 2%. So figure out what you are giving percentage-wise now, and then ask the Holy Spirit. Dare to ask the Holy Spirit to guide you in what your giving should be in 2022. See, I've already impaled you on the horns of a giving dilemma, Because if you decide, no, I don't want to pray about it to the Holy Spirit and ask him to guide me, that's puts you in a separate category. He'll be faithful to work on you, because the one thing we don't want to do is say to the Holy Spirit, leave me alone, because then the issue isn't our giving, it's our relationship with Jesus. But let him guide you in your giving. It could be a tithe. It could be incrementally. If you're giving 2% or 3% right now, he could show you what would 4 or 5% look like. You see, the money's here. It's just a matter of people being obedient, us being obedient, and letting the Holy Spirit guide us in our giving so that there'll be enough in this storehouse for God's work. And then finally, what will be your increase in giving for 2022? I pray that it will be a higher percentage than it is this year. And I believe if you'll be obedient to what the Holy Spirit quietly places in your heart, you will experience what Malachi 3:10 talks about. You will experience a blessing in here that cannot be described or experienced in any other way. So two things I would leave you with. First of all, what I said earlier, never put yourself in a position where you're trying to figure out how to give God less. And then finally, an obedient giver is what our scripture said at the beginning, a cheerful giver. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Good morning. Habitat for Humanity International was founded in 1976 by Millard and Linda Fuller, who developed the concept of partnership housing. The concept centered on those in need of adequate shelter working side by side with volunteers to build decent, affordable houses. The houses would be built at no profit. New homeowners' house payments would be combined with no interest loans provided by supporters and money earned by fundraising to create the Fund for Humanity, which would then be used to build more houses. Habitat seeks to put God's love into action by bringing people together to build homes, communities, and hope. It strives to demonstrate the love of Jesus Christ by building affordable housing and promoting people's dignity. Habitat currently works in all 50 U.S. states and more than 70 countries around the world, and has helped more than 35 million people achieve strength, stability, and independence by having safe, decent, and affordable shelter. One in three families in our Cape Fear region spend more than one-third of their income on housing, make it hard to pay their other bills and achieve financial stability. Habitat is on a mission to change that. With the support from volunteer labor and generous donations, Habitat works to provide a better, healthier life. Habitat homeowners spend no more than 30% of their monthly income on housing, which provides financial stability, security, and a chance to leave a legacy for the next generation. Founded in 1987, as an independent affiliate of Habitat for Humanity International, Cape Fear Habitat has served more than 250 hardworking families by constructing and rehabilitating homes throughout Pender, Duplin, and New Hanover counties. Each year, thousands of community members come together as volunteers, donors, and future homeowners to help solve our region's affordable housing crisis. In 2021, Cape Fear Habitat hopes to finish 21 homes. Habitat offers hardworking families a hand up, not a hand out, to build equity, financial stability, and self-reliance through affordable home ownership and financial education. Affordable home ownership leads to better health, better education, and better neighborhoods. Habitat homeowners have low to moderate income, a stable employment record, and a decent credit history. Participants qualify based on their need, ability to pay, and willingness to fulfill the sweat equity component, helping to build their own future homes and those of Habitat neighbors. In 2019, our church partnered with Cape Fear Habitat to build four houses on a large lot on the corner of 15th and Ann Streets, two blocks from our church. In 2020, we built a house on Castle Street. This fall and winter, we are partnering with two other congregations in our neighborhood, Trinity Methodist Church and St. Paul Episcopal Church, to build a house on 16th Street, just two blocks from our church. The owner of this house will be Renee Perez, a custodian for New Hanover Schools, who works primarily at the high school. She will have completed almost 400 hours of volunteer work with Habitat before she takes ownership of the house. Many adults and older youth participated in the 2019 and 2020 builds or served lunches to construction workers. On behalf of T. Worrell, Donna Phillips, and myself, I encourage you to sign up at the Habitat site to work on this new Habitat house. Construction will begin in mid-October and take about 5 months to complete. We will again also need church groups to provide lunches for workers. In addition, you can help fund this house by sending a check to our church. Cape Fear Habitat stresses that 100% of these donations go to build houses. None of it is used for their overhead. Please let me know if you have any questions or concerns. I hope to see you at the construction site this fall or this winter as we build the 10th house together with Habitat for Humanity. Please join me in our prayer this morning, concluding with the Lord's Prayer. We're going to be celebrating with the 2021 confirmation class, whose members were confirmed this past Sunday. We're continuing to celebrate with Rob Lapp and his family as he transitions to a position as interim pastor at the Southport Presbyterian Church. This morning, we're praying for Lee Wilson, who had a stroke on September 19th, and was released from the hospital 2 days later with a heart monitor. For Tom Papendick, who had a cardiac catheterization on September 20th and was discharged the next day. For Nancy Brown, who received a pacemaker on September 21st. We're celebrating with Isabel Jewell, whose 98th birthday will be this Wednesday, September 29. We're praying for Anna Marie Aiken's brother, David Sisonek, who's recovering from heart surgery, for Jane Shelton's brother, Bud Kizak, who started radiation and chemotherapy for bladder cancer, for Molly Lowry, who is hospitalized with COVID pneumonia. We're thinking about our brothers and sisters in Manaus in Brazil. Patricia Matisse reports that COVID there has decreased, both in the city and in the Brazilian state. Their church has returned to in-person services on Sunday evenings and to Sunday school classes. They continue to provide social and psychological assistance to those who are suffering because of the pandemic. They've also resumed their ministry to villages along the Amazon and its tributaries. So let us now join our hearts and minds together in prayer. Pray with me. Our Father God, we thank you that you are a glorious, awesome, and wonderful Father, one who loves your children, one who provides so generously and benevolently for your children, a God who is so worthy of our praise and adoration. We thank you for sending your Son Jesus into this world to be our Savior, to teach us, to serve as a model for us, to guide us, to direct us, to show us how to live and who we should be. We're thankful that this resurrected Jesus now reigns along with you and serves as our mediator and provides us through the Holy Spirit with the comfort and assurance and power we need to effectively serve you. We pray this morning for our church. We pray for Robert Bailey, our interim senior pastor. We pray for all the members of our staff and the important work that they do for this church and your kingdom. We pray for our elders as they provide direction for our church. We pray for our deacons as they serve people in the church and the community. We pray for all our Sunday school teachers that you would give them wisdom and guidance. Help us to be a church that serves and loves Jesus, that makes Jesus known in the community, that truly is a light to this neighborhood and beyond. This is indeed a challenging time in the life of our church, given the numerous transitions we are going through and the many difficulties associated with COVID. But Father, keep us strong, keep us standing firm, keep us doing your will, keep us united as one body in Christ. And Father, we think this morning about our world. We think about all the challenges that are there as well. We think about concerns about climate change, poverty, refugee resettlement, war, violence, religious persecution, human trafficking, this and many more things that are afflicting our world, problems that we need to come together to try to resolve. So be with the nations of our world as they meet through the United Nations and in other capacities, that they might truly work together to abate the spread of COVID, to make sure that people are vaccinated, to decrease poverty, to address the issues that afflict and affect our planet. We pray for our nation as well, Lord. We pray this morning for the border crisis, especially for the conditions in Latin America that are driving so many people to come here who want to leave violence and poverty and gang-related activities and come to a land of greater opportunity. But Father, we pray for the remedying of the problems there, that people would be able to live more healthy lives in their home countries. We pray that we would be truly generous and beneficent toward those who want to come to our country. Help us to do what is right and just. Be with people who are victims of fires, of droughts, of the effects of hurricanes, of homelessness, of racism. Help diminish the political animosity that so deeply affects our country. We pray for President Biden. We pray for our Congress. We pray for Governor Cooper. We pray for our state legislature. We pray for all our local officials that they would seek guidance and direction and wisdom from you. Father, this morning we do pray for Lee, Tom, Nancy, Isabel, David, Bud, Molly, all our brothers and sisters in Manaus and Malawi, especially Pastors Nonato in Brazil and Pastor Silas in Malawi. Father, you are a God who loves us beyond our ability to comprehend. May we bask in that love. May we share that love with others. May we truly be disciples of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the one who taught us when we're together to pray this prayer: Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Now receive the benediction from that greatest statement of giving ever given to humankind. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him might not perish but have the gift of eternal life. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit go with you and remain with you always. Amen.